I will explain some process of the Shim, like review and sign and the delivery. And some, you saw the keyword, the name, you know who, the Microsoft requirement, and the latest is the SBAT. Okay, the first is Shim. Just in case anyone does not touch it before, so Shim is the first bootloader before the grub 2. It only work on the UEFI firmware environment. So it's a one EFI application. The pointer is a license. It's a license, the BSD2 cost patent. Is the more important, actually the most important, because Microsoft don't want to sign anything about the GPL3. So that's why we cannot direct send the grub 2 to a Microsoft side. That's why the Matthew Garrett created this project and give a BSD license. After that, we put more function in the Shim, like MOK, and use the DB to verify binary, to verify the secondary bootloader, and also we support the TPM to extend some PCR, like PCR 7 and PCR 14 for the SBAT and the MOK. So it's a one very simple chart. UEFI firmware has the image loader, and it load the Shim, then Shim load the grub 2 load the kernel, like this. Okay, then it can do the verify when secure boot enabled. UEFI firmware verify the Shim, and the Shim verify the grub 2 verify kernel. Actually, this chart is simplified. Actually, grub 2 load the kernel to the memory, and the grub 2 request call the Shim protocol to verify the kernel. We'll have a detail later. Okay, and Shim, as we know, Shim is a project, and we use it in SLA and openSUSE. So we applied some SUSE downstream pages, not too much, only 4, and we want to reduce that. On the other hand, a special things. I mean, I'm not sure other component, but Shim is special. All SLA and lib versions are shared one binary, only one binary. So another. Like openSUSE tumbleweed, use the same core, but the only difference is the built-in certificate. It's a built-in SUSE, openSUSE CA. And SLA and the lib use the SLA CA. It's after the closing lib gap project. So lib shared the Shim with the SLA. Then another special thing is this component is a Shim, must be sent to the Shim review project on the upstream before signed by you know who. Yeah, we must pass the review. I'm not sure other component must do the things. Maybe Shim is the only one. So when you think maybe I have a very good idea, a very special idea to, hey, we can put many cool features to the Shim and then to watch everything. Yeah, it's not what I also want to do that, but we must pass the review. It's also always a problem. Oh, sorry. The last pointer is, it's also important. The last pointer is a version upgrade coming. It's not always upgrade. Only when the zero security issue happen in the Shim or grub 2, for example, boot hole zeros. Yeah, okay.
So
Sorry, I did not capture that. Thank you.
So the question is, is there a strict requirement that there is only one certificate in the shim? Can't we put both the openSUSE and the SLE certificate in the same shim and be done?
Yes, but dangerous. Yeah, if we can put many certificate in the one shim, but after it, the shim be revoked, then everything revoked. So if we found maybe one bad security problem in the slab, maybe only revoke slab shim, and the openSUSE tumbleweed shim may be safe, but deep not safe. But if we put the same certificate in one shim, every certificate in one shim, then maybe if the shim be revoked, then everything have problem. Currently, Okay, thank you. Then maybe we can discuss, but yeah, it's a current problem. Current situation, not problem. One highlight, this presentation is not, I want to promote something or I like whose solution. I just want to explain the current status. Yeah, not I like it. Maybe I even hate it. But maybe. Yeah, it's a recording, right? I cannot say too much. Okay, the process of Shim. Sorry, the word, some word maybe small, but the slide will share after the talk. It's a building process for one new Shim and the Shim review Docker file. We need to provide one Docker file on the upstream. Then anyone want to review our Shim, they can use a Docker file to reproduce the building of our Shim binary. So it's a requirement. Is a request by the Shim review project. And in the Shim, of course, we need to build our Shim. So the yellow color means it's on the OBS, and the green color is in the IBS. The yellow color, we always from the factory, normally, from factory and Shim project, Shim package. Then, because we all know the factory is not quite stable because the tool chain maybe change or something like object copy maybe change. So we need one stable base to build out our binary and also the Docker file. So we create one sub project under the factory. The name is a secure boot, secure-boot, and they have one Shim package. And we put a 15.4 lib base, the repo under this project. Then so our Shim binary be built out for the tumbleweed is based on the 15.4. Actually, it's not based on the real factory. So then, like the yellow color Shim, after build out, it has the openSUSE CA embedded in the Shim binary. And also have the openSUSE sign key signature. It be generated by the SUSE sign key. Those part is done by our security team, SUSE security team. And Johannes will create a Docker file based on the 15.4, actually the latest stable openSUSE release, and the Shim. Of course, but before we send to the upstream, we need to strap the signature because we don't need it. Then the green color, the slashing, the path is similar. Just based on maybe the latest stable release, like currently is 15, slash 15 SP4, then generate the Shim. It's an embedded slash CA and also attached the slash sign key signature. Of course, we need to strap the signature before send to the upstream. Okay. Then the on upstream, the blue color means now we on the upstream, actually the GitHub. So the our security team, Johannes, he will he has one fork from the Shim review and create two issues. Actually, we use the issues to run our workflow. And the one is openSUSE is for tumbleweed. And another one is for SUSE/Shim, is for SUSE and lib. And it includes the Shim binary and also the Dockerfile for anyone want to help us to review our binary and to check, to review, to make sure it's reproducible of our building. Then it submits to the Shim review project. Then after some review, we need to collect maybe two, as I remember, or one or two key men's approval. Yeah, then after that, after we pass the reviewing on the Shim review project, the security team will send it to the Microsoft Sign by the one secret channel, yeah, quite secret. Then after the Microsoft saw the sign, then it sent it back to the security team. So we got the one Shim attached Microsoft signature and also a Shim for SLAY attached Microsoft signature. Then security team sent it back to me or Dennis. So the problem is, maybe not a problem. sometimes, actually not sometimes, it's almost we were blocked. The whole process will be blocked on the Shim review project and also blocked by the Microsoft. We don't know what happened sometimes. Just like last time we sent a new Shim in last year, before the end of last year, but we got the 15.7 Shim back maybe around before last month or last month. Wait a couple of months. Yeah. So it's the Shim review project on the GitHub. It's under the Red Hat Boot project because they host this review project. And all distros should be sent to this project for review. Not just us, not just Red Hat, not just Ubuntu, everything. Every distro, including MicroFocus or some Chrome, Google Chrome, or any distro should be reviewed here. Okay. After the Shim be signed back from the Microsoft, which means we got the signature from the Microsoft, then we will extract the signature. Then here is a bit complex because we don't want to direct use the binary with the signature in our product because we want to double check the hash of the Shim to make sure it's reproducible of the building. So we just extract some information and combine them to one file, one binary file. The name is signature-openSUSE and ASSC. So it's a hash of a sign-based Shim and also the timestamp link and checksum in the PE header and the Microsoft signature. Then we update the ASC file in the OBS or IBS, then generate our real Shim of the openSUSE tumbleweed or SLAY, then we deliver it. Okay, then here is a detail of the double check the hash of the Shim before we deliver it. We do not really direct use the Shim from the Microsoft. Yeah, so Microsoft signed back the Shim, then we extract some information from the PE header, because we will restore the information after we reproduce the building of the Shim binary. Then we also extract the Microsoft signature, and also the calculate the hash of the side, the batching. Then it's a one process locally, and on the OBS or IBS in the Shim spec file, because we update the ASC file on the build service, then the spec file will generate Shim binary again. Then we will restore the information in the PE header. Then we calculate the hash, then compare with the hash of the signed bastion. If two hashes match, then the Microsoft signature will be attached, auto-attached to our Shim, then we deliver the Shim. It makes sure the Shim can be reproducible. Yeah. So I just mentioned we only use one binary for all say or lib versions. So here these trees, I draw this tree like this. The latest slay, the stable release. This example is not for the 15.5. 15.7 is for 15.4. At that time, I draw this diagram. So we based on the latest slay stable release to build out our Shim binary, the package. Then some older slay version repackage. Based on we put the RPM to a local project, then the spec file just repackage it, open it, then take a binary repackage it, because we want the serial number, the count of the package can be added for those older slave. Then some children slave version, inherit from the loser mother, yeah. And the lib, the yellow color box is also inherit from our Shim from the 15 SP3. Now it's a 15 SP4, yeah, like this. Okay, then Microsoft requirement. Maybe, yeah, because we need Microsoft sign, so they have one document. Actually, I cannot find all the document, but they have one document in last year to mention this. Maybe last year, I forgot. So they have many rule in the document. The first, we need to use an EV certificate, and they only sign the production quality code, which means we cannot send one development call to them for sign. And the call submit for the UEFI sign must not be subject to the GPL V3. So they, for example, GPL GUAP2, they don't want sign GUAP2, so that's why Shim be created. Yeah. It's a concern, it's a Microsoft's concern. Maybe not our company, but Microsoft say they don't want. Okay, then have one other policy. You must first submit the Shim review project for reviewing before sign. And the call sign key must be backup, stored, and recovered only by the personally in charge of the rules. It's not me. Is a security team in SUSE. I'm happy. Then, okay, we need to design, the submitter must design and implement a strong replication mechanism for everything, the Shim load, directly and the subsequent. The replication mechanism actually is only one. Not only is the DBX in the UEFI firmware. Yeah, not Maybe we hope it was, yeah. And they, Microsoft requests more things for a new Shim, non-SQ or no-SQ flag and the 4K alignment. The old Shim do not have this. I guess maybe it's because of break routers. Yeah, because Microsoft Bootloader we found a problem, so they request more policy. The effective day is 2022, yeah, the end of last year. And session alignment must align 4K page. And session flag must not combine the write and the execute, of course, because the code and the data must be separate. And the binary must stay the NX compat flag. Actually, Microsoft provide one tool to verify it, so can help us to verify the EFI binary file to make sure it pass their check for their requirement, including the 4K alignment and also the NX flag. So Peter Jones, the maintainer of a Shim project, now he put a patch in the end of last year to enable the NX flag, compatibility flag by default. It's out of the Shim 15.7, but we backport it. Yeah, if we want to disable it, we can use the one compiler option to disable it. Okay. Then we got one Shim. How can we know it was for the NX flag, NX memory partition? So we can modify the OVNF to check it. OVNF is the one sub project in the EDK2. It's a firmware can be run in the QEMU KVM. So just a very simple, put the GCC option -z common page size to the 4K. Then not just here, we need to put three session in the OVNF description. Is for some different stage, like SMM call is for page label partition. And runtime driver is for support the memory attribute tables, and like a DXC call or application is for NX partitions and so on. More important is this. This one is also in the OVNF description. We need to enable some. It's a bitmap. We need enable some flag to tell the firmware. We should enable the read-only and also the non-executable, and some memory regions cannot be set to the executable, like they have one 77FD4. We need to check the bitmap is have one table say the which bit is for the which memory regions. So we need to say it. And Project Mu, even that the Microsoft create one project is, yes, they are developing the firmware based on the EDK2. They claim that they used it in their machine, their Surface Zero. I'm not sure because I did not check. And they provide one QEMU firmware, the name is a Mu Tiano platform. It can be run in the QEMU to they modify the memory partition sub system. I did not check the core yet, but they modified it in the EDK2 to support the more functions of the NX. And then they provide it's a only implementation. What I know is it provides EFI memory attribute protocol. It's a new protocol in the spec. to let the OS or bootloader to change the attribute, the memory attribute of an NX flag for some reason. Kernel boot. Kernel also affect. And now, since 5.19 RC1, my English is not good. Basically, this author he added one page to the. It's just a workaround. It's the red use the DXE service. DXE service is for one stage in the UEFI for the driver execution. DXE driver execution environment. So it can use the protocol. It's not really protocol. It's one service to change the memory, the flag of the memory regions. So it direct change those regions to the writable and the executable. So it's just a workaround for the kernel can be run on based on those, if we found this firmware. So, but it's not perfect. So then after that, he tried to send a one page set to to the version 5 to improve the that in the compressed kernel stage. And it supports a new protocol I just mentioned in the new spec. It's safe, more safe, because the PI spec is for like a UEFI driver. But this protocol is a boot pump service, is for the like OS and a bootloader, is better. So, but after review, it's not finished, so the art is he sent a more patch set for these things. So now it's still under development. And we are watching that and try to help to test it on the OVM and the Project Mu. Okay, so I only have 2 minutes. SBAT. So SBAT is a tag, can be used to block or revoke some untrust the binary, EFI binary. Why we need it? Because the DBS, we said the only one mechanism to revoke the EFI binary, the space in the firmware is a limit. Is upstream say that around the 32 KB. And until the 2021, we already use the 50%. It's almost a full, very quick. So and also we start to support the SBAT to put a tag in the EFI binary, and since 15.4 is support safe check, so the Shim can self block itself. The old Shim can block itself when a new Shim be installed on the machine, and old Shim cannot be wrong. Then 15.7 fully support SBAT policy. And we can use the object dump to check the SBAT session, to check the string, and also here have 2 EFI variable, and it's save the SBAT variable. Separate BAT string in the variable for checking. We will have a diagram to show up. Okay, like this. At the beginning, we do not have the SBAT string in the NVRAM. So this first version we support it is 15.4. So it's a CSV format. So we put a one string in the SBAT sessions. So when booting, the Shim will to check the UEFI firmware. If it does find the variable, SBAT variable, it will create one. And the user is an SBAT string. So it's the first one. Then after that, if we installed new Shim, then the new Shim will go to check the timestamp, day stamp of the SBAT. Not just date stamp, including the SBAT version and the date stamp. If the date stamp is is a later, then it will update, replace the old one, old SBAT string in the variable. Then after that, if my machine already installed a new Shim, but we still run the old Shim, why old Shim must be blocked? Because it have a maybe security problem. So the 15.4, it can self-block itself. So the SBAT session has the version Shim 1. The component name is Shim, and the generation is 1. But the EFI variable, it says we have installed one new Shim on the machines before. So the component is a Shim, and the version generation is a 2. So 1 less than 2, so it be self-block. And we can also block GRUB2. GRUB2 also has support SBAT session. So in this case, like GRUB2 is the generation number is 2, and the generation number in the variable is 3, so the GRUB be blocked. We can also block kernel, but not support yet. So the same, the kernel be load by the GRUB2, then the GRUB2 call the Shim protocol to verify the kernel. The same, we check the SBAT, but now it does not support yet, because no one send the page to kernel. Maybe nobody want to touch it. So maybe bootloader first, yeah. So but block kernel is possible. Actually, we can block anything. If we support multi second level bootloader, we can block anything behind after the Shim. Okay, here have some case about the security violation error. I put here because I got some bug. They say, okay, I got a security violation error, but actually they are different. Have four case. The first case one is the Shim real have problem. The firmware cannot run the Shim or low Shim, so you will see this security policy validation. And the second case is a self-block. The Shim be self-block because the SBAT does not match all too old. So it will show like this. And the case three is normally we saw this. This blue box be actually is exposed by the Shim because the GRUB2 did not pass the check of the SBAT or even the signature did not pass the check. So it show like if you see the one blue box, then this means the GRUB2 cannot match with the Shim. The case four is a kernel. Kernel also maybe be blocked. Kernel does not support SBAT, but the kernel has a signature. And the signature maybe does not match. Maybe it's too old, or maybe Shim be updated. But kernel did not update, so it's also possible you see this. Okay. Maybe too much. I put too much slides as usual. So it's a SBAT policy, and I address SBAT actually not just one string. Actually, back to here, like 15.7 have three policy. One is a delete or original policy. It's the first SBAT string in the Shim. And so if you run the MLK util to delete it, it will roll back to the original, the oldest one. And the previous is the last release SBAT. And the latest is now, or now SBAT. So you can choose which policy. It's a bit complex because I want to write one openSUSE wiki to play it because some guys playing it and found it's strange, the behavior is strange. So I put one table, but the more useful is this chart. I draw it. So Default state is a previous. If I install one Shim, it'll use a previous state SBAT to override the EFI variable, SBAT variable. So we can use the MOK util to push it to the latest state. But after you go to a latest state, or you from the previous state want to delete, or we say clean to the original state, then it's impossible when the secure boot be enabled. So we need disable secure boot, then we can go to, we can run the MOK to delete the SBAT string to set it to the originals, the oldest string. So in this case, maybe latest or previous want to go to delete or original state, we need disable security first. Then after that, we can from the original state to the previous. So latest state cannot direct back to the previous. It must go to the original, then back to the previous, which means the security boot must be disabled first. Okay, finally, that's the page. Next, what the next? And the point is we sometimes block by the stream review or when Microsoft assign. So the point is stream review, now Dennis Chen working on the upstream to try to improve our quality on the upstream to help other distro to review their stream. Then we hope other distros maintainers can also review our stream, because we cannot review our stream. Yeah, it's not make sense. So it's a closed review. So we want to build our quality. And we will try to reduce the downstream page. Yeah, because without downstream page, then our stream is totally the same with the upstream stream. Just the only difference is maybe the tool chain or some other things. So, yeah. Sorry. No, I finish. Okay. Okay.
Then there is a lunch break after, so we can delay. It's up to you.
Oh.
If there is some questions.
Okay. Yeah.
If not, then we can go.
Okay. So upstream features like we are trying to support multiple second stage bootloader. Now only support grab two, and merge the fallback and the MOK manager EFI to the stream. EFI is for TPM measurement. Okay, is it what? some reference document. Okay, thank you. So if you have any question, just ask me after the meet session. Thank you.
Thank you.